Thank you, Senator Butler and Imara. Now, please welcome Brooke Migdon, staff writer at The Hill, and our amazing panelists to the stage.
Hello, everyone. We have a great panel for you today. We're all really excited. Let me introduce these great people to you real quick. We have Sarah McBride, a state senator in Delaware and current U.S. candidate for Congress. We have Malcolm Kenyatta, state representative from Pennsylvania, and he's currently running for Auditor General in Pennsylvania. Brian Derrick is the co-founder and CEO of Oath and a political strategist. And Ashanti Ghalor is the president of Emerge. Got some fans out here. So thank you all for being here. I'm really excited for this discussion. I guess if we could start, let's start with 2024 and some predictions that you guys might have for the year ahead. Brian, do you want to take that one first?
Sure, I'm happy to start. As has been noted already from Senator Butler, we all know that we've seen a huge number of attacks on the LGBTQ plus community for the last 2 years in particular, as we've seen Republicans really invest in a strategy to try to divide and gin up their base of support, and they think that they can use our community as a punching bag to do that. And I think that when it comes to 2024, what I am most concerned about for the LGBTQ community is more and more candidates and electeds doubling down on that strategy. And when legislative sessions return, that we're gonna see an increased number of attacks compared to what we saw in 2023. At the same time, we have, I think, a bit of a apathy problem and an engagement problem on people who are champions of equality, and we need to see a paradigm shift if we're going to be able to combat those attacks that are coming our way.
Mm-hmm. And Ashanti, how do you think we can get there? Are there any candidates or races that you're keeping your eye on for 2024?
Oh, of course, at Emerge, so many candidates. I know we have so many of our great Emerge alums who are in the audience. Love them. But if I were to just, I'll keep it simple, not trying to take all of the time, like three, obviously we have to get Congresswoman Becca Ballant reelected. We know how important that is, and for us at Emerge to see what she was able to do, actually being the last state, Vermont, to send a woman to Congress, an LGBTQ woman, that's really important. I think of my home state of Nevada and the fact that we continue to see more LGBTQ people elected to our state house. I'm really excited about Michelle Montgomery, who is a first-time candidate, black woman. That's going to be a game changer. And of course, Brianna Tatone from Colorado, getting her reelected. And I know we're talking about 2024, but a highlight for us at Emerge for 2023 was seeing our Emerge Virginia Executive Director, Danica Rome, win her race. No, she is now State Senator-elect Danica Rome, and she's a trailblazer once again, being the only person who is openly transgender to be elected to both chambers of a state house. And I think that continues to show us how important candidate recruitment is, the work that the Victory Fund does in supporting these candidates. They're out there, but they need to know that they have the support of organizations and people. And we know that the voters will get there. We continue to see it. We just have to make sure that we have that representation. And in 2024, we know we have so much to fight for, especially when it comes to Biden and Harris. We got to make sure that there are great down ballot candidates as well, because that is surely going to be our winning coalition for 2024.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a really, really important point. You know, just to follow up on that, like, how can we get voters engaged in these down ballot elections, like excited about these elections? You know, because we know that looking at the data, voter turnout isn't really what we want it to be. So maybe Brian and Ashanti, if you guys want to take that one as well.
Definitely jump in there. At Emerge, our focus is on the new American majority. And when I became president, I had the opportunity to work with the team to set our vision for the next 15 years. We went really bold. And we looked at who were the people who are actually turning out and getting these great candidates elected, especially LGBTQ plus candidates. And it was the new American majority. And we wanted to move to not only having them vote for these people, but to put their name on the ballot because they were exciting them. That's when we're having voter turnout, and LGBTQ people are a huge part of the new American majority. So that is where that connection is with the candidate excitement to voters. They want to vote for people that look like them, that understand them, but most importantly, they know will fight for them. Because so many people, I mean, we just get to sit back and watch Congress every day. They see that their elected officials are failing them, and they are just unapologetically doing things to harm them, their communities, and their families, and they want the good candidates. So there is that opportunity there when we have the right candidates on the ballot. That is what drives voter enthusiasm.
Yeah, and I will just add to that to say that you have to meet people where they are in language that they understand. And that is the Oath model. I launched Oath about 2 years ago, and we help Democratic donors figure out where their dollars have greatest impact. And so our entire model is getting people really excited about races and candidates they've never heard of. But by tying that to issues and opportunities that they can really make a difference, where their time and their money will go a long way, we have found has gotten tens of thousands of people engaged in state and local elections for the very first time. And so I think that the more you can drive what the impact is, whether you're talking about voting or giving or volunteering, but really centering on the impact of an individual's actions, of something that is within their power, even if it's something as simple as posting on social media, but getting that message to them in a language that they understand and on the platforms where they're already spending their time.
I think we tend to focus a lot on what's happening in Washington. But as we all know, as Imara and Senator Butler were talking about, there's been a tidal wave of state legislation targeting the LGBTQ community, not just this year, but in past years as well. As we look to 2024, you know, maybe this is a question for Malcolm and Sarah. What can we expect in terms of anti-LGBTQ legislation on the state level? And, you know, how likely is it to affect LGBTQ candidates?
So I think what's clear is that we have seen over the last few years a cruel and concerted effort by MAGA extremists to target not just the trans community, but trans young people in particular. I think it's in part a byproduct of the fact that they have been searching for the new boogie person, and this is part of a longer-term strategy that they have utilized to try to divide and conquer and win elections. I think it's also a byproduct of the fact that they understand that these young people are badasses, and they're trying to stop them before they have the chance to grow up into the full, beautiful, incredible adults that they will become. And I think, you know, we've seen a number of different bills. We see bills around healthcare. We see bills around schools. We see bills around books. We see efforts to utilize child welfare agencies to strip trans kids away from their parents. And I think the through line of that strategy and of those policies is that these politicians, these activists are seeking to rip away any layer of support that a trans young person might have. Parents and providers, teachers and teammates, coaches and classmates, friends and family members, to leave those kids isolated. And the consequence of that, we know, is to make life so difficult for these young people that some of them never grow up to be adults. And I think we have to be crystal clear about what the stakes are. But I think what we also are seeing consistently is that these policies ring hollow with voters. They don't speak to what is keeping people up at night. They seem completely out of touch that while people are worried about rising costs, these politicians are focused on whether government's gonna get in the way of patients and providers getting healthcare, that they're trying to talk about trans kids playing sports. And I am wondering when, and my hope is that in 2024, these right-wing politicians, when they'll realize that the country doesn't hate trans people to the degree that they hate trans people. They are delusional in their interpretation of what the realities are out there. And it is my hope that this coming year, while we will continue to see these policies percolate in state legislatures and sadly pass in state legislatures, we'll also see them increasingly struck down in the courts. We'll see more and more trans people in particular mobilized into running for office in response, because as we have seen in so many places, I see Zoe Zephyrs here from Montana, our presence serves as such a powerful visual heuristic for someone who's watching as to what side people should be on. And our humanity contrasts with their humanity in such a powerful way. And I think the more we have trans people running, the more we will not only have a presence to push back on these policies, but the more we will educate the country in a way that inoculates them from any political efficacy of these attacks. And I think in so doing, we will have a historic year in 2024 when we elect a record number of trans people to public office up and down the ballot, where we defend our state legislators that have already been elected, where we elect new state legislators like Lisa Middleton in California. And is it shameless to say that in response to all of these attacks, we will finally elect an out trans person to the US House of Representatives?
Thank you for that answer. Malcolm, in addition to a tidal wave of anti-LGBTQ legislation, we've also seen a extremely sharp increase in anti-LGBTQ rhetoric, especially online. I'm curious how and if you see that playing out politically in 2024. How will it affect candidates running and the broader community?
Yeah, thank you for that. You know, the tragedy is, even for the bills that don't pass, there is a psychological impact to constantly seeing your very humanity be up for debate. Your idea, this idea that you have to engage in a political battle to use the restroom, to exist in public space, to have your humanity respected in the way that everybody deserves as a baseline, that has a psychological impact. And I think we can't underestimate the impact that that has on each and every one of us, and particularly folks who raise their hand to run for office or to be a part of a campaign. There's so many candidates in this room and who aren't in this room who know what it means to receive death threats, to have to change your routine or talk to law enforcement about something that somebody has said online or something that somebody has mailed you or emailed you, whatever the case may be, present company included. But I would say that two things. I actually do not believe, and Sarah touched on a lot of this, that beating up on trans kids is good politics. Right, right. It's not actually good politics. I mean, I would take For example, what happened in Pennsylvania in the Central Bucks School District, which got a lot of national attention, where these bigoted school board members who wake up every day, I mean, just think about what that takes. I'll get a cup of coffee, and then how do I make life difficult for a trans kid in Bucks County? We flipped every single one of those seats. Every single one. In a county, mind you, that has always been a very swingy county. You know, anybody asks me what keeps me up at night, Bucks County. But I will tell you, Bucks County has proven over and over and over again that folks are actually interested in policymakers making policy that impacts their life in a positive way. And a part of what it's also done, I was hosting an event for the candidates who are running, and they did this cool Quizzo thing, and I don't usually like Quizzo, but I won my round, okay? I want to put that out there on the record. I won my round. But what was so interesting about this group of folks that they assembled is of every table of five, two to three of those people had never been involved politically before. I had one table that I sat with of all former, all retired librarians, and one librarian said, you know, I voted, kinda, but I was a librarian, and I never thought about who was on the school board. It didn't, like, matter to me. I thought, you know, maybe this candidate wants to build a gym, this candidate wants to build a football field, but it was never something that registered to a point of, I need to go be engaged. I need to knock on a door. I need to talk to people about the impact of this. And what drove her to action were the horrific statistics about young people who she had been there for, helping them pick up that first book, who were now considering not continuing this bold and beautiful life that they are called to live. And that caused her to wake up. And so, you know, for all these folks who are out there, I think bigotry, as much as it excites a certain grassroots movement that can be violent and dangerous, we need to never lose sight of the movement that we have, of the power that we have. And when you know that you're fighting for all the chips, when all the chips are laid on the table, when you tell somebody your very right to exist in public is at stake, I think in 2024, folks in this room and outside of this room are gonna fight like hell.
And for our political strategists over there, you know, we know that these issues don't really play well in elections, right? Could you say more about that?
Yeah, I mean, what we have seen since Obergefell, since same-sex marriage became the law of the land, is that Republicans have been looking for, as Sarah put it, a new boogeyman. And they think that they found that in the trans community in particular, and they have invested year after year, really since 2016, in messaging to, like I said before, turn out a base that it is animating for, but will never win them the middle, right? And elections, as everyone in this room knows better than anyone, are won and lost in the middle. And as both of you have noted, that continues to be where they prefer bigotry and hateful rhetoric over their own re-elections and advancing their own majorities. And they've paid the price for that. You look at 2022 and what happened in Michigan and in Minnesota and in Pennsylvania, where Democrats flipped chamber after chamber and are winning these down ballot races where they are making this the central focal point of their campaign. This, I think, dovetails very well with the fight for reproductive rights, where, again, you have a party that is choosing an extremely unpopular and far-right position because they are so attached to the extremists and so driven by the extremists in their wing of the party, instead of who's going to actually advance the concerns and policies that will help the vast majority of Americans.
And I definitely agree with all of that, but we can even just see how deeply unpopular it is when we look at the South. Look at what happened with Kentucky. For us to be able to get Governor Beshear reelected, Lieutenant Governor Jacqueline Coleman reelected, they leaned into the fact that this is hateful, this is wrong. And people tend to think that on these issues, we have to have different messaging for blue states, red states, purple states. Like, no, all of it is just wrong. And we need to be clear and say that. And that is resonating with voters. We can even see it in Virginia. Glenn Youngkin spent $13 million of his own PAC money to have control of the state Senate and the House of Delegates. That man wasted $13 million. Because what we have now is Democrats controlling both chambers, but what does that mean? That is the protection of abortion. That is protection of trans rights. It is the expansion of healthcare. All of this ties together, and that's something that I always talk about is we need to speak of it in that way. All of this is about freedom. The freedom to live our lives the way that we want to. And unfortunately, right now, when it comes to state senates and state assemblies, Republicans have control of almost 30 of each. And that tells us why we have such a hard time and why we're not seeing more pro-bills. We're seeing a lot of anti-bills. We have to keep up the fight, especially at this state level. We have a lot of people who are paying attention to Congress, but what these past two elections have told us is that we do have voters who know that the state and local matters, especially when it comes to protecting communities.
Can I actually just build off of something that sort of came to mind for me, and I wouldn't typically talk about this, but we're in a room of wonks. I'm an American University graduate. We called ourselves wonks. But I'm in a room full of wonks, folks who understand this work better than so many others do. And I want to make a point about something that we've all talked about, but I want to add an asterisk to it, which is, yes, these anti-trans policies are not politically effective. They ring hollow with voters. They don't win elections. And when Republicans prioritize them, it doesn't work out for them on election day. But we should also be clear that we can't mistake that for us having won the conversation on the substance of the policy yet. And I think it's easy to become complacent when we're talking about sort of the silver linings of these of this moment, when we're talking about where voters actually are on sort of the prioritization, which is, I think, a conversation we've won. But we haven't won the conversation yet on the policies themselves. And we have to be very clear-eyed moving forward about our ongoing work that's necessary as a social movement to continue to educate people, to continue to fight on the merits of the policies that we have. Because quite frankly, the sad truth is that while these don't win on election day, over the last few years, we've seen a regression in public opinion on trans rights. And so that only reinforces the work of advocacy organizations and advocates on the ground. And yes, it reinforces the fact that we have to have LGBTQ people in public office to continue through the power of our presence and proximity, both explicitly and implicitly, educating colleagues and the public around who trans people are, because at the end of the day, the reason why we have not yet won on the substance of these policies yet is that people still do not have a clear picture of the full diversity and greatness of the trans community, and we can only achieve that if we exist everywhere. And so that is an important point for us to reinforce.
I'd like you to say a little bit more about that. Part of what you're saying, if I'm getting it correctly, is that Republicans who have made this an issue are controlling the narrative at this moment. How do we get it back?
Well, I think, I don't know that I would say they're controlling the narrative, because I think the voters are very clearly rejecting their narrative, that it is a priority to target trans kids. The voters are very clearly saying, this isn't a priority. And I think we have to be crystal clear as we continue to campaign that this is an effort to distract from the fact that these folks have absolutely no policy solutions for any of the actual issues that our country is facing. But I think my point is that I think we're winning the narrative on the prioritization. We have not won the narrative on the specifics of the policy. If you ask a voter, do they think it should be the top priority of a state legislature to ban trans kids from sports consistent with their gender identity, they would say, no, it shouldn't be a priority. But unfortunately, far too many would still say, yes, but if the issue's right before me, I don't think that trans kids should be able to participate in extracurricular programs fully. And that is a sad reality. And so we can't mistake the victory on prioritization in public opinion with a victory on policy in public opinion.
Ashanti, you kind of touched on this earlier, but you know, we haven't seen pro-LGBTQ legislation move at the same pace as anti-LGBTQ legislation. What are some expectations for 2024 when it comes to pro-LGBTQ legislation for anyone?
Yeah, I would, and I, Sarah's point is well taken, and I think, you know, we are nonpartisan in this moment, but I think it is very clear that the Democratic Party has been more forthright in defending the rights of folks in our community. But as a big Philadelphia Eagles fan, just go Birds. If you are not, I feel sad for you.
Go Birds.
Go Birds. There is a big difference between stopping the other team from advancing their agenda and advancing your own agenda. And a part of what that requires is some very difficult conversations within our own party that I think was just illuminated with Sarah's answer. You know, Pennsylvania just passed out of the House of Representatives for, it's taken us 22 years, but at least out of the House, a bill I prime sponsor known as the Equality Act passed out of the Pennsylvania House of Representatives. We've introduced for 21 sessions, finally got it passed. But we have to be very clear that that was a fight within our caucus to go beyond saying we're not going to allow a trans sports ban to happen versus we are going to make sure that life is better for every single student because they matter. We introduced just a couple of days ago a package of bills, prime sponsored by so many of my colleagues, to do just that. To make sure that every single school in Pennsylvania has LGBTQ inclusive curriculum, to make sure that there are broad and clear policies around bullying and restorative justice that put people in a position to get the very education that they need to get about who our kids actually are and why they should be able to be on that team, why they should be able to use the bathroom facility of their choice, all these different things. And to be very clear, there are going to be members in my caucus who are going to say, well, we shouldn't really, you know, let's not make it an issue. Let's just say we're against what they're against. But as I say all the time, we can't be running against something. We have to run for something. And what I believe we have to be for is the dignity of every single student to be safe, respected, and cared for in every environment that they're in. And that's going to require some tough conversations within our own caucus. But I do believe that when you run, when you talk about these issues, you can't do it from a scared place. When you come to people with this idea of, maybe you're not going to be able to have that conversation in your community if you are not affirmative in your belief that everybody matters, here is why, here are trans people, this is why their existence is not only not a threat, but why their existence should be championed and we should encourage them. And it has required real tough conversations in my own caucus, in my own party. And so, you know, I think on the how do we shift the narrative on the policy, that has to start with the people who say, well, I'm not going to vote for that bill, But then the second part is, what will you vote for? Understanding that our community is under attack, and that requires us, many of us, maybe the first or one of few in our legislative body, but we have to be willing to have those conversations. I know you're having those conversations, and I think they're making an impact.
Thank you so much for that thoughtful answer. So, talking about pro-LGBTQ legislation, I kind of want to focus on some of the bright spots of this year. Maybe if we could go down the line, starting with Sarah, talk about some of the victories that we saw this year and, some of our potential successes in the year to come.
Sure. Well, first off, I think we have continued to see state legislatures move forward, not just non-discrimination protections, but the sort of second wave of pro-equality legislation, from bans on conversion therapy to bans on the LGBTQ panic defense. And actually, there's a story from the state Senate in Delaware that, for me, was probably the highlight of my entire time in the legislature as an out trans person, specifically in that context. And that was as we brought forward a bill banning the LGBTQ panic defense in Delaware. So I had earlier in the week announced my campaign for Congress. And as many of you have experienced, whenever we try to do something new, it gets a lot of feedback. Fortunately, much of it was positive, but of course, a decent amount of it was negative, and some of that was downright violent in not just rhetoric, but in threat. And because of that, we had increased security in the state capitol, and that was something my Democratic and Republican colleagues knew. And coincidentally, 2 days later, with that increased security visible, I brought forward the LGBTQ panic defense bill. It had passed the state house on fairly partisan lines. And we brought it before the state Senate. I stood up, I gave my opening remarks explaining why it was so necessary to make it clear that there's no excuse for violence against the LGBTQ community. And I paused to prepare to do what so many of us do all the time, which is defend our dignity, defend our rights, explain that our humanity calls us to denounce violence against our community, to say there's no excuse. And I expected my Republican colleagues to stand up and to say, at best, this was a solution in search of a problem, and at worst, to say that it might even be understandable that someone would be so disgusted by someone like me that they would be inevitably drawn to violence. And amazingly, that's not what happened. Because in that moment, with that increased security visible, my Republican colleagues stood up, and to a person, they not only declared the dignity and worth of LGBTQ lives, they not only said to a person that they would be voting for the bill, but led by the most conservative member of their caucus, they all asked to be added as co-sponsors of the legislation. And look, that is a low bar, right? Saying that there is no excuse for violence against the LGBTQ community, voting for it and becoming co-sponsors is quite literally the bare minimum. But what I think happened in that moment, and what I try to remember even as I'm facing the sort of the coldest of hearts and the most closed of minds, is that what happened in that moment was more profound than the single policy. Because what happened in that moment was that those politicians understood more fully that the political is fundamentally personal. That what we're talking about here is not an abstract issue. It's an issue, it's a policy that impacts people that they know, and yes, people that they care about. And that doesn't always happen. It's not going to result in them leading the Pride Parade tomorrow. But you can't undo that synaptic connection once it happens. You can't undo that connection between policy and people, between the policy and humanity once it occurs. And it has been through those small, almost invisible moments that so much of our progress has been made. And so as we continue to move forward, I think all of us recognize that as important as it is to celebrate those big, huge advancements, marriage equality becoming the law of the land nationwide, passage of non-discrimination protections, let's also take stock in those small moments of progress that ultimately lay the foundation in the long term for us to deliver the change that we still so desperately need.
You know, so much of what we have to be proud of in this moment is to the left and right of you at your table. With so many people who are stepping up to run unapologetically, to run for offices they would have never run for before, and to win. And to win. I mean, Tyler Titus just became the first openly trans member of the Erie City Council in another perennially swing county in Pennsylvania. We are in a position where I mentioned we passed the non-discrimination protections. We passed out a judiciary. We're on our way to the LGBTQ panic defense. It's going to be on the floor soon. Send us some of your senators, because I'm worried about what's going to happen in the Senate. We'll give them a pass to be senators of Pennsylvania for a day.
We won't have anyone left in Delaware if we send you our six Republicans.
We'll take them, okay? We'll take them. But also, I think really what I'm more proud of is to see some of the fierce allyship that we're seeing. And I go back to Bucks County because I think for all of you who have doom scrolled the latest poll, and for all the people who want to talk about polls, I think when there is a loss for our movement, when there is a loss for folks in my particular party, I think that is front page news for weeks. And had we lost the race in Bucks County, I remember all the pre-articles that if they lose here, that means the end of everything. When we won and won every single seat, when we reelected the commissioners after having millions and millions of dollars dumped against them, it didn't get a lot of, you know, national celebration, but I will tell you that wasn't just driven by folks at the Rainbow Room, this incredible LGBTQ center. This was driven by, as I mentioned before, that librarian, folks who never saw themselves as opponents or allies to our community, who just never thought about it, who were seeing the intersectional nature of our rights. And I think the abortion bans and the Supreme Court decisions and Clarence Thomas saying very clearly after the overturning of Dobbs that this is not where I want to end, that there are other communities that I would also like the states to go back and maybe look at that. I think that has awakened a lot of people in a very profound way that I think we need to take advantage of. We certainly should not assume that it's just going to happen on autopilot, that people are going to make that connection. But when you do make that connection, when people see the fact that when we talk about bodily autonomy, we have to mean that across the full spectrum of bodily autonomy. If we're going to say we're not getting in the doctor's office for an abortion, that means we're not getting in the doctor's office for any medical procedure for anybody. When you start making that connection, powerful things can happen. And I will say this to each and every one of you who are thinking about running, who's in that space. I said it in a little plenary earlier. I think there's this sense that you need to in some way apologize or justify your presence. No, the hell you do not. Not only do you deserve to be there, every single time an LGBTQ person is elected to office, that place is better than it was before because we're there. And we have to walk in with that sense of our shoulders back and our heads up, feeling a sense that, like, it's not a gift for us to be in these places. You're not giving me something. I am bringing something to this space that wasn't there, and you are lucky that I brought it.
So I'm hearing these two different truths from this incredible panel of individuals. We have these really harmful and urgent attacks that are happening all over the country. And we have all of these reasons for hope and optimism at the same time. We're living at a time when your zip code as an LGBT person has a lot to do with the rights that you have and how you're seen by your community and by your state house. And there are so many reasons for us to celebrate 2023. I believe 12 states now plus DC have affirmed the right to healthcare for all people, including trans people, and have become safe havens in a way. And we're seeing the places where pro-equality officials have the power to do so, a leaning in that I don't think we've seen before, where people say, we're gonna go the extra mile to make sure that these rights are protected and that anyone who comes here is going to have the dignity and the healthcare and the safety that they need. And at the same time, we have all of these reasons to be concerned. And so for me, I really lean into those victories and where we see the first out lesbian elected in New Jersey and the first woman mayor of Philadelphia. And all of these really incredible historic firsts that we're seeing this year, those are the moments that I think that you have to really lean in and celebrate the win so that you have the energy and you fill up your tank to go fight the fights that are an uphill battle. And so in the same way that we have really blazed trails for the last 10 years, I think it's a victory fund stat that we've doubled LGBTQ representation in public office in the last 6 years, which is incredible. We also have so much more work to do, and the best people, the best talent, and the resources to do it if we are using them strategically and building the infrastructure to look for those, to turn those year after year wins into long-term sustained power that is going to protect the rights of the entire LGBTQ community.
I agree with what everyone said. Obviously, I get so happy when I see our LGBTQ Emerge alums get elected to office, but I become even more excited when I see what they do in office, when we have multiple of them in a governing body and how they're able to get those bills passed and come together with other Emerge alums who are LGBTQ allies. I just think about what our alums were able to do in Maine, especially for trans kids, trans teens, LGBTQ students, is going to be a game changer. But what really puts the biggest smile on my face is when I see other alums reaching out to them saying, how did you do it? Because we want to do it here. Teach us. It lets them know that it can be replicated, and it gets them excited about what they can do and that there is hope. So we know, as much as there are some not great times and issues and policies that we have to deal with, I love the way the Emerge Network always comes together to say, you did this, we want to do it here, let's work together.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you for that. Thank you, everyone, for your great responses. We are unfortunately out of time, but I want to just thank our incredible panel here for this really, really incredible discussion.